Hello, and welcome to today's event, Racial Alterity, Wixárika Youth Activism and the Right to Mexican City, a conversation with Professor Diana Negrín, Pablo González, and Maria Pérez. I am Janet Wagaman, the program coordinator at the UC Berkeley Center for Latin American Studies. I'm happy to be here today and have the opportunity to host you all for the last installment of the Spring 2023 Novedades, Lançamentos, New Scholarship at Berkeley series. This series highlights new work from UC Berkeley scholars on Latin America and the Caribbean. As with every great event, this one has a multitude of people who have worked to make it come to life. Thank you to Gregory Lauren, Julia Berth, and Natalia Brizuela of the Center for Latin American Studies for your tireless work behind the scenes. In a minute, I will hand you over to the speakers for today's event. But before I do that, let me provide their brief introductions. Diana Negrín is affiliate faculty in the Department of Geography at UC Berkeley, specializing in topics related to territory, ethnicity, and social movements in Western Mexico. Professor Negrín's book is Racial Alterity, Wixárika Youth Activism and the Right to the Mexican City, which was released by the University of Arizona Press in 2019. In this book, Professor Negrín examines the legacy of the racial imaginary in Mexico, focusing on the Wixárika indigenous peoples and revealing how Wixárika youth are making claims to a more heterogeneous citizenship that challenges these deep-seated discourses and practices. Negrín sheds light on the racialized history or urban transformation and contemporary indigenous activism of a region of Mexico that has remained at the margins of scholarship. Professor Negrín will discuss her book in conversation with Pablo González and Maria Pérez. Professor González is a Chicanx Latinx Studies continuing lecturer in the Department of Ethnic Studies at UC Berkeley. He studies the resonance of indigenous social movements of Chicanas, Chicanos, and people of color in the United States. Maria Pérez is a PhD candidate in the Department of Geography. Her research looks at racial geographies and geospatial representation. During the event, we welcome questions from the audience and have enabled the Q&A feeder. You can see it down below on Zoom. You can find the Q&A button on the bar below me. Now, I hand it over to Professor Negrín.
Thank you so much, Janet, for the introduction. I'm going to now share my screen and folks can... Hopefully you guys can see my slides. Okay. Well, I wanted to start first by thanking Dr. Pablo González and future Dr. Maria Pérez for agreeing to read and participate in this conversation. And I want to thank the Center for Latin American Studies for the warm invitation to share this work. It's been oftentimes difficult to find audiences in the United States to speak about issues of indigeneity. And so it's always very exciting to have the opportunity to talk about this work north of the border. I would like to acknowledge our presence on unceded Ohlone territory as we think about what brings us together this evening in this virtual space that is also UC Berkeley. So today, what I want to focus mostly on are some of the themes that run through the work that went into my book, Racial Alterity, Wixárika Youth Activism, and the Right to the Mexican City. And I want to give special attention to how this research came together under the umbrella of geography as this very interdisciplinary discipline. And I also want to note that I'm speaking of this as what Gloria Anzaldúa calls a threshold woman, a Nepantlera, who grew up between Guadalajara and Berkeley, who grew up in between and with so many different communities. I'm speaking as a woman who came to Berkeley as an undergraduate and later as a graduate, and as a woman whose positions have shifted, but are very much linked to this place, to this university, and to how this university connects to other spaces and places that I have loved and that I have learned from. So in the next few minutes, I just want to break down some of the key aspects of this book, how the project came together. It was published in November of 2019 by the University of Arizona Press, and it was an interesting moment because the pandemic hit us right afterwards. And so much of this work I've had a lot of time to think about more in private than in public. So I'm really excited to have the chance to speak with a wider audience. So basically in the next few minutes, first I want to speak to what I knew and felt from my embodied experience growing up in Jalisco and traveling over a lifetime to Nayarit, which are the two main geographies that I visit in this book. And then I want to touch on what I read in the archives and in the scholarship. Right? These archives included the Bancroft Library, my own father's archive, nonprofit organizations, and popular culture. And lastly, I want to conclude with what I have learned through engaged and collaborative ethnographic work with urban indigenous organizations and where we are at today, 10 years after completing the bulk of the research that is in this book. So just to give you all a first little approximation to the image we are seeing, this is a photograph that was taken by Kupuli Bonilla as young Wixárika urban residents reached the floor of what would be the Congress in Guadalajara in Jalisco, demanding their rights to these different territories that I will speak to. And what you see right here is the God's eye. It's this quincux, it's this five-pointed, it's got 4 points and then this center. And that's symbolic of what we'll see in this next image, which is Wixárika ancestral territory, the sacred lands of the Wixárika people that extend across this pretty big geography of what is Western, but also Northern Mexico. And it's brought together again through this cartography of the Tsikuri, which has often been labeled a God's eye or el ojo de Dios. And to the, and you know, you'll see to the right, an image of the map of Mexico, the nation state of what we know today as Mexico. But I want to juxtapose these images, these cartographies, because I think they're very important for understanding the context in which Wixárika youth are moving across these different spaces, some of them ancestral and sacred, others contemporary and alienating and urban, but through doing so are asserting their belonging to all of these different spaces. So I'll get there, but I wanted to show these first as context before I return to this other image that I just kind of want to sit on. As I think a little bit and I speak to first how I came to this project, in Latin America, we've been listening and hearing the term senti pensar more and more, right? This idea of thinking, feeling. And I think of senti pensar, of thinking and feeling, as one of the primary methodologies that I use for inquiring and knowing about what it is that I'm talking about today. This starts in my childhood. Although I am not Wixárika, I grew up in the context of my parents' work in Wixárika territory. And my first memories are in Wixárika territory up in the Western Sierra Madre mountains of Jalisco. And as I came to consciousness, in the midst of very intense debates between indigenous elders, authorities, maracate or chanters, and the Mexican government, which was consistently seeking ways to diminish their territory and to constrain their rights to movement outside of their territory. I moved here when I was 11, here to the Bay Area when I was 11, in part because of the work that my father was doing and my mother were doing in terms of land defense. And my mother being from the United States felt like it was a good time to move here. And despite this, my extended family continued to be these different compadres, comadres who I grew up with, who were Wixárika, more so than mestizo Mexico or the upper class white Mexico that would otherwise seem to be the natural link for me and my identity as a güera, right, in Mexico. These first experiences are part of that thinking and feeling that led me to this work around race, identity, and activism in Western Mexico. And it got even more intensified as I navigated my own identities across time and space, my own identities in California and in Jalisco. Later, my own identities as I became a graduate student and navigated other types of expectations in the university. And it is at that time that I started to speak with a lot of my Wixárika friends who were also students about their experiences navigating higher ed, navigating urban spaces where they were oftentimes seen as unexpected bodies. So this research, again, it began as a doctoral student, but it extended itself across my postdoctoral studies as I continued to work with Wixárika colleagues in different moments, from advocating for more spaces in the universities in Mexico to advocating for the protection of their sacred lands in these different geographies that we see here. This work continued through my ongoing collaboration with the majority of the people whose stories cross the pages of this book. And with that, this sentir pensar came with responsibility, with humility, and with openness for the relations that we were building through these conversations and the stories that we could tell by thinking more specifically about what it meant to be in today's contemporary Mexican cities. Lastly, this work was reinforced through the mentorship of elders, of Wixárika elders, and of non-Wixárika elders who oftentimes call themselves Huicholeros. Huichol is the Spanish term used for Wixárika. And there was a whole crew of Huicholeros who my parents belonged to, who were allies, non-Wixárika allies. And they also very much influenced this work. Professors Percy Hinson, Dick Walker, Guillermo de la Peña, but also this commitment to seeking a bridge between scholarship across borders, feeling of frustration as somebody who had grown up multilingual, who had grown up as this Nepantlera, and seeing that so much of our scholarship seemed to be bounded within these particular regions. It was difficult to have conversations around Black geographies and Indigenous geographies. And that was also part of the motivation behind this work. It's reflected in the dialogues that I try to create, between the real people who speak in this work, but also the scholars that inform it. So with that, I want to then move to the second part of what I wanted to present today, which I call our archival foreclosures and openings. And I want to speak more specifically to the research that I did for this work. And it in part was influenced by geographer Alan Pred, who passed away my first year here at the geography department, and his work on racism in Sweden. Specifically, what inspired me about his work was this method of using chronological and spatial interplay. And in my introduction, I write, through the action of zooming in and out of history in a spatially grounded way, we can better understand how ideas of race and racial hierarchies become part of a society's common sense and are facilitated through visual and literary technologies intricately tied to state practices. So in my research, I was able to actually get a year grant at the Bancroft Library, which has a really amazing collection of works on Western Mexico. And it is in that time where I was immersed in these archives that I was able to think more critically about the role that the archive played in both what it told us and what it didn't tell us about the reality of Western Mexico. And I think this was in part troubled by the fact that even if we look at kind of scholarship on Mexico, there tends to be a tendency to leave out the West. There was very little critical scholarship on Guadalajara, on Nayarit and Tepic. And so much of it I had to construct. And a lot of it was built through piecing together everything from scrapbooks and photo albums that were created by visitors to Mexico. It was put together by maps made by unnamed foot soldiers during the Spanish colonial period and by early US prospectors, by regional newspaper reports and op-eds that I found in the archive. And those I was able to put into dialogue with the writings of Franciscan friars, Scottish merchant turned bandits turned colonists, and a diversity of scholars dedicated to the undertold stories of the Mexican West. I would say in many ways, this book, what it is more than anything, a dialogue across these different genres and with the young people who were part of this story. Why was I drawn to the question of representation? And I think because of this, I knew that Edward Said had taught us something, right? That the multi-genre archive that is mapped onto peoples and places is fundamental to the capacity of nation-state governance, but also to actual forms of multicultural neoliberal governance. And I'll stop here to just speak a little bit about these images, right? Two of the big themes of my book are archival foreclosures and then the work of hypervisibility, which I will get to in a second. And what I was so interested in was that although the Mexica people and the Maya people had been the imperial indigenous people that so much of the Mexican nation state had kind of sampled itself on and utilized in very interesting, sometimes problematic, sometimes beautiful ways. What I kept finding was that Wixárika culture also had been this, had had a particular space of visibility, especially in Western Mexico. And increasingly today, the Wixárika people had become a sort of poster child for the Mexican government and for a series of different private enterprises. So everything from, you know, a campaign like here you see to the soul of a culture, a door opens. That's an advertisement that I found in front of a yacht club to the north of Puerto Vallarta. That whole area has over the last 15 years used Wixárika aesthetics, Wixárika words to rebrand itself for the tourist, right? As a place of indigeneity. Here we see that very, very visibly with these words, right, in English. This was meant for an English-speaking tourist audience. And then the other image that we see is of Rebeca Iturbide, who was a Mexican actress during the age, the classical, the época de oro in Mexico, of Mexican cinema. And I came across a whole archive of images of Rebeca Iturbide and other white or mestizo models utilizing indigenous clothing, and in some instances, Wixárika clothing, as part of this relationship that has been established between the Mexican state and consumable, safe indigenous culture. And this thinking really helped me understand the place that current young people, young Wixárika people, found themselves in as they negotiated with these images. Oftentimes, these images speak of the Wixárika as it is linked to their shamanic practices, to peyote, to the beadwork, but it reduces the idea of the Wixárika within these very specific frameworks. So I was really interested in the way in which representation works over time and across space and the material implications that these representations have over time as they are recirculated and repurposed, and how this creates a racialization of space and a spatialization of race. So I looked at Tepic and Guadalajara as these juxtaposing examples. They're both cities that aren't that far away from one another, but they have very different senses of identity. Guadalajara has typically always been seen as this colonial kind of European space, whereas Tepic has really utilized its past as this indigenous rebellious place to even name itself, right? Nayarit itself comes from the name of King Nayar, who was a Nayari or Cora leader. And what I write in my book is that the image of the indigenous is essential but problematic component of Mexican identity, and it dates back to the nation's colonial foundations. The appropriation of Wixárika culture by private and public entities illuminates, though, a dynamic in which fixed notions of Huicholness meet up with the everyday fluidity of residents, indigenous residents in Tepic and in Guadalajara. So this just leads me to the last part, which is how is it that young university students who have multiple roles, they're not just university students, they're also working in a diversity of professions, living in different neighborhoods of the cities, and constantly negotiating what it means to move across these spaces. And so for me, this question of dignidad rebelde, of dignity, of a rebellious dignity, speaking up and speaking back to these colonial imaginaries becomes important. And so during the period in which I was researching this, this work, Antonio Hayuaneme wrote to me one night. It was the night before the big celebrations, official celebrations that the government does of Indigenous people. And he was embroidering his traje. And this is what he embroidered, and I have it translated for you guys. But Day of Indigenous Peoples, learn about the reality. And then on the flip, on the backside, it says sacred sites for sale. Wirikuta, which is one of their most sacred places in the state of San Luis Potosí, for $3 million. At the time, there was a great controversy over mining concessions, a day to remember our blood. And this to me is just a snapshot, right, at the way in which Wixárika youth have consistently been pushing against the coloniality of Mexican society, of Mexican urban society, the hyper visibility in which they exist, which for me, the way I've theorized hyper visibility is that it is a technology that asserts some sense of equality and inclusion while hiding the ongoing violence behind those images. So for me, there's always this presence of negotiation, contestation, what one of my favorite scholars, Eduardo Lisson, talks about as opacity, right? Our right to engage on our own terms. And I know we're out of time, so I'll stop here, but you know, Eduardo Lisson really helped me understand this idea of a poetics of relation, the careful right to difference that exists in the right to opacity, in which peoples do not have to subjugate themselves to full disclosure and reduction, but can choose the times and places in which they wish to reveal themselves in their difference. Further, right, there's this search for freedom within particular surroundings. And I think that a lot of the young people who are now not so young, who I worked with, you know, what's been amazing 10 years after finishing this research is that there have been some significant changes. So Guadalajara has gone from being a space that was incredibly hostile to Wixárika youth to becoming a space, thanks to the work of Wixárika youth and elders, that is much more inclusive. So, you know, right here are just two images. On Saturday, there's gonna be a dance this coming Saturday. An activity. And what I love about it is that this flyer was done basically 100% in Wixárika. There's no need to translate it. There's no need to seek out a particular type of recognition from Mexican, mestizo, Spanish-speaking society. And then to the right, one of my friends did an installation in downtown Guadalajara. And below these God's eyes, these sicuris, there is a whole map of these sacred sites that are here. And I think that these are some of the elements that provide me with hope. And I wanna end with this quote by James Baldwin. I am what time, circumstance, history have made of me, certainly, but I am also much more than that. So are we all. And these words that Baldwin shares speak so much to what I see young Wixárika people doing today, right? Understanding, and all of us, right? Understanding that we are what time, circumstance, history has made of us, but we are also so much more than that. And in these two images on the left, it's a group of Wixárika women who were giving this workshop for other Wixárika youth and small farmers about how women have been asserting their leadership in their communities and what it means to be feminist from a Wixárika perspective. And then to the right is a picture of a student who just is graduating this spring, holding a sign that says, neither earth nor women are territory of conquest. So with that, I'll end. I'm excited to hear what Pablo and Maria have to say. Pampa Ariyutsi, thank you. And those of you who do want to support Wixárika students, I do help run a scholarship program that came out of actually this research and conversations where there was a sense that there needed to be some autonomous support for their studies. So I'll stop there. Thank you so much.
Yes, I'll begin. I think that's part of the idea. First of all,
adelante, Pablo.
Yeah. First of all, thank you so much for the kind invitation to talk about your amazing book, Diana. I've known the Negrín family now close to 30 years because we're Berkeley born and bred and raised. So it's kind of it's an honor to read and engage your amazing book. And in part because it crosses more than just in the field of geography. I think this is as pertinent a study for questions of education, especially around Indigenous education, just like it would be around mobility, social mobility and social inequality, obviously race and ethnicity in Latin America, but also how we might be able to see some of this, especially now with so much migration, both internal migration, which I think the book really captures a lot of that, especially around rural to urban migration and how the urbanization of cities like Tepic and Guadalajara. But even if we were to see like the majority of studies being done on Mexico City, for instance, where we see most of the studies around indigeneity emerge from, that these can now maybe help us also understand as Indigenous scholars themselves are working on this in the United States, especially with transborder studies and in other places like Europe, for instance. I actually wanted to begin with a couple of remarks that I think makes me reflect on the recent passing of, I think, one of the most beloved intellectuals in Mexico, Don Pablo González Casanova. And I want to, you know, in this sense, take the time to pay respects. And I have some of this, I think, to think about Don Pablo or Comandante Contreras, as the EZLN and the Congreso Nacional Indígena had ennobled him in terms of his work, that his work, I think, is pertinent in many ways to thinking about the contributions here in this book. At least it resonates for me. Thinking about the intersections of your work with U.S. ethnic studies, and in particular with, I think, one of the more prominent ones throughout the continent, which is internal colony. Not to say that this is a continuation, but I think it resonated with me, especially when thinking about particular locations in places like Guadalajara that are constructed or that were marginalized, especially with indigenous migration to those areas. And while many have gone away from the model, don't ask me why. I think it had to do with some other thing. during the 60s and 70s, it definitely ushered an important conversation over urban and rural internal migration and spatial arrangements around race and class, and in particular, colonial continuities, which I think you discuss in great detail. To that point, Don Pablo argued that Mexico was a dual society nation, right? And I think that's important to think about, especially in the mid-20th century. For the indigenous populations, all the different communities in Mexico and throughout Latin America, that's obvious. But then to suggest that it's a dual nation is to break away from this idea of mestizaje and the mestizo nation, right? This idea of the nation state of the Mexicano or Mexicana, like the very construct of what it means to be Mexican. And so to then further that line, especially being impacted and resonating with the struggles that are happening in Africa and in Southeast Asia, and to include Latin America in that, I think is important. And to that, you know, for us, for the many indigenous communities of Mexico, this represented since Mexican independence, and I think you marked this, the nation state building project of mestizaje and their erasure through assimilation into social categories like peasant and other categories throughout the coming centuries. And so it in part, we see this in education, right? Your ethnography mentions these students, Wixárika students speaking of this, right? They're like, I didn't want to say that I was Wixárika. I didn't want to do this. Or when I did, they always asked me in this kind of pluri-ethnic Mexico post-92 that could I wear mi traje típico, right? This the sense of having to prove my indigeneity, which I think is that last chapter really highlighted all of these things in regards to these professionals and students. And it also constructed indigenous life as strictly forming, this idea of the internal colony always constructed in a sense, especially in Mexican anthropology, but also US and European anthropology on Mexico, of Indigenous life only stemming from a rural particular geography, right? So if they did not come from particular Indigenous communities, then they weren't Indigenous. If they didn't wear the traje típico, if they didn't speak the language, all these were markers, colonial markers of difference that that produced and reproduced the type of social inequality and markers of what indigeneity meant in Mexico in particular. And so the internal colony model, I think, was able to at least mention those things, especially in the urban context that many U.S. ethnic studies scholars and activists themselves pursued. And for them, for those scholars, it helped them look at, for instance, the prototypical racialized enclave like the barrio and the ghetto of the U.S., right? For Stokely Carmichael, like Carlos Munoz and Mario Barrera, the internal colony was an indictment of U.S. white settler colonialism and white supremacy. And these internal colonies, like examples of the barrio populares or the neighborhoods in Negrín's study, are both sources of cheap disposable labor. And in Negrín's study, we would see, for instance, artisans, but also the housemaids and housekeepers who live in these particular locations. And in particular type of consumption of the other, right? Now in Tepic, it becomes, you can now, you know, ride a bus and it'll end up there, as you mentioned so poignantly, like, now you will be able to not only visit some of the constructed sites of Tepic, but now you can add on to that this indigenous representation that Tepic now has been constructed as, right? So I think that's super critical in understanding the differences that you talk about, especially around Tepic, Nayarit, and Guadalajara, Jalisco. And I think that I think it was marvelous just to read. But more importantly, I think in the work of Comandante Pablo Contreras, González Casanova, was to support the idea developed by the Pueblos Originarios, which is the concept of an other geography, right? Otra geografía. And this other geography, I think, is a part of your book, especially around the way that Wixárika students and professionals are themselves mapping out this urban landscapes and their relationship to their communities outside of Guadalajara and Tepic, yeah? Many of them who are born and raised there in these cities, but some of them who have migrated to the city. So we have to, again, not think that it's something of the migration process, but they are born in these locations, many of them. So in thinking about that, and I think in this concept of the other geography it can challenge state and social arrangements of power and place in Western Mexico. And what I would like to discuss more is how do we decipher and read these other geographies using the pedagogical and methodological tools developed by Wixaritari to walk in many places, or this concept of Makuyaika. And more so because, you mentioned your positionality, right? This how do we understand this question of, besides the fact that anytime anybody cites Jackie Alexander, I'm going to read the book. And so the very understanding, like pedagogies of crossing and thinking of these other methodologies, you know, Jackie Alexander was as much inspired by the work and in conversation, not only with Gloria Anzaldúa, but also with Chela Sandoval and others, thinking about these intersecting identities and differential identities, I think is crucial to really understand how you are thinking through what many of these Wixárika youth and professionals are saying to you. And, you know, I'm not going to go into detail. I was going to go thinking about, some of the points that you make, especially in the central chapters of Guadalajara and Tepic. But I guess this is where I just wanted to really think about the question that for me was important in the way that some of my work is around identity formation, right? That in regards to identity formation, especially in the last chapter, thinking about how they engage and negotiate dominant notions of cultural authenticity and spatial belonging is crucial. There's so much that we can take from that. And here I would like to just kind of end with a way in which we've been thinking about, for instance, identity formation in these encounters between, for instance, Chicanas and Chicanos in the United States with Zapatista indigenous communities or other communities, even the Congreso Nacional Indígena. And while there's differences, those differences, some of the similarities that resonate is this question of how in two distinctly different locations, the question of identity, of who, of being, is brought up so important around assimilation projects, one in terms of white supremacy, but the other one in terms of mestizaje, in terms of being an in-between identity or multiple identities and what that means. All of these things have been constantly in conversation to understand and to bridge what would otherwise be clear differences in communities. And I see that your work is really trying to do that as well, because many of them walking in multiple ways and also within walking in many places, you also have this other notion of, like, while you're walking in these places, there's this other formation, right? So you have these other geographies where people walk in many places. Those are the other geographies. Then you have the state formation, right? And those state formation geographies are the ones curated already for you, right? For you to only step into certain places, for you to step into certain places with particular types of racial, social regimes. And I think, and for your place to also reproduce them, mind you. That is, that in you wearing the traje típico, you are also reproducing what the state wants you to, especially in a post-92 moment, right? And how can one not reconcile, but how does one navigate that or speak to that, especially if you are a Wixárika youth in particular, or professional and student in the university. The other thing I think we can talk about is that while we have two different locations, Guadalajara and Tepic, I would love a conversation around the university as a site of this, because the university is always viewed as separate from any particular place. I mean, look at Berkeley. I mean, UC Berkeley is separate from Berkeley in general. So how itself as its own geography is also constructed in that way, right? Especially these very elite institutions in Guadalajara that are the reproduction of that Hispanicity that Guadalajara is constructed to have, right? So, I mean, these are some of the initial questions. I went off my different list that I have, but I know that I'm a little short on time. So I'll leave it to Maria, because I definitely want to hear.
Thank you so much.
Can you guys hear me?
Yes.
Cool. Okay, cool. So thanks so much for including me in this. And I have so many different like moments and points to say, but I feel like the most poignant was that I read this really in relation to thinking about Black geographies, which I feel like my work situates the most. And I just noticed that there's like this rhythm to your writing and how you structure the book, and that you really do engage like Black studies, like Black thinkers. And I wanted to try to read some of your book alongside thinkers like Winter. So I have two texts that I was sort of reading racial alterity like with, and it was one of Sylvia Winter's essays from, I think, 1992. It's Do Not Call Us Negroes, How Multicultural Textbooks Perpetuate Racism. And the other, which is a really dear book to me, it's called Lessons from the Damned, Class Struggle in the Black Community. And so I saw that in how you structure your book, actually in framing the ethnography and the stories of students, I saw so many tie points between thinking about Blackness and indigeneity together, and also thinking about race and class and the nuances and struggles that students were able to articulate are actually struggles that I've had to articulate and navigate myself. And so I saw actually there were a lot of kind of personal points in just reflected in many of the stories. I think just also the structure of your book, it actually reminded me of Clyde Woods's Black Geographies. To make that jump, I'm like, oh, this is like, at one moment I wrote, this is a wonderful regional analysis, like a really strong, like local historization, starting with like the 1500s of the history of this place, and really taking the theory and the history seriously in framing these two cities, Tepic and Guadalajara. So there's this rhythm, there's the framing, which I think like, okay, this is really powerful geography. And then there's also bringing out the stories.
So one of the things I wanted to talk about, I think of the three, was thinking about multiculturalism, education, higher education, and mestizaje, and the myths that they do and perpetuate for both Black populations and Indigenous populations, just like reading them together. So I was like, oh, this is when, as you're framing kind of the myths of nation making and building, I'm reading Winter and I'm saying, oh, this is what we're talking about in like Black studies. Like this is what Black studies is actually confronting as well. It's this notion that the education system, so if it's the US or the Mexican education system, might be embedded with these kind of series of articulations about race and this presumption of colorblindness or inclusion or of multiculturalism. But what they actually do is what Winter, I'm using her framing, it's presuming a particular cultural model that essentially posits blackness and whiteness, or a Eurocentric white migrant, in opposition to each other, where the Black American population essentially serves as an alter ego to this normative ethnic or normative citizen framing. And I actually saw a lot of continuities with how Tepic students were struggling to articulate their own identities, and also struggling to articulate, well, it's actually embedded in the higher education system. It's embedded in our first grade textbooks, or as you yourself were arguing, these are tropes that we've been taught and socialized with and against. And so for Winter, I'm thinking, or I was thinking a lot about how these different binaries function and work, and how even in like a predominantly non-Black country like Mexico, you still see kind of a similar trope of anti-Blackness, which is really hidden at the root of it. And with mestizaje, it functions in a little bit of a slightly different model. And so for Winter, in Winter's text, she argues, there's one quote that I want to pull. Let's see if I can find it. I have my notes that are a little bit all over. Let's see. Okay, so for Winter, she writes that the Latin American cultural variant of this model maintains this Black-white binary division. The offspring of this mixture, it's looped into a mestizo category or an other, which then becomes a norm. But the, in essence, what it does is it maintains a similar social hierarchy or hierarchicalization of populations that are still in proximity to a Eurocentric norm or Eurocentric whiteness. And so I saw this as students were articulating, oh, I'm dealing with colorism or tonalism, even within my own community, like being mestizo, but also how I'm being read either as mestizo or not, like if I can pass, if I can't pass. And so I saw a lot of these continuities and struggles. And so I thought it was really powerful to try to read like Black studies and also Black geographies alongside Wixárika identities. And so thinking about how this category of the other is constructed and reified over and over and reframed. And you do this really well by pointing out how it works through representations as well as just through narratives. So another point I'd like to kind of touch upon that I guess really, really spoke to me is, let's see, thinking about how you're framing the ethnographic stories of students. In many points, I really noticed you had a poignant articulation of just like giving voice to students, or like letting kind of their sections of text kind of speak for themselves. But then you'd also put in a really important note of actually describing, well, this is a lighter skinned student. Like this is a, like, you know, kind of adding in your readings of racialization in that student's identity to say, like, this is like another way of looking and framing and actually thinking about how people are read. And I think that was actually really important I don't know if I've read this in other contexts before, how we can kind of add annotations to speak to identities of how students might be read, and thinking about how identity is both self-created, but also it's imposed upon by ourselves and others. And so I thought that was really important. Another thing I was thinking, or that really spoke to me, was class and class struggle and tensions. And so this came about when students were articulating kind of this striving, or I guess the promise of a college education is kind of getting to a higher class or a middle class background, and how often this is actually something that I think Black American students would strive toward as well. But for many people who are lower class, it's actually kind of becoming a false trope that you are saddled with debt, or there is no promise of a job. There is no promise actually of upward mobility. And so I saw like a lot of continuities with thinking about class tension. And so Lessons from the Damned, one of my favorite books, if anybody has read it, I have the PDF, I am willing to send anybody. I think it speaks to this primacy of the middle class and how even within communities, Black or Indigenous, there is this still class hierarchy where the middle class can actually oppress, at sometimes often the college educated middle class, feel the need to go back and then speak for or try to impose our opinions on poor working class people, even within our own communities. And I saw that tension there as well. And I kind of live it every day. I'm thinking about how to navigate kind of these nuances of class, even within the same community and also across. And I think speaking to that, you also kind of touched on this notion of alienation when you are kind of cherry picked or given a scholarship and you leave and you come back and it's like struggling to find the same language or grappling with an identity that has changed. And I think that's another kind of continuity or tie point to think across communities between Blackness and Indigenous student groups and populations. For instance, like my granddad grew up as a sharecropper in the Deep South, and every single time I talk to him, never fails, he tells me, "You talk too fast. I think you need to slow down," or "You sure ask a lot of questions," or just he asks me to clarify, and I have to then remember to pick up like a different frame of reading or like kind of code switch even within my own family. So I think it was powerful to read other students, other non-Black students actually going through similar processes as well. And so the last point I really wanted to touch upon thinking Blackness and indigeneity was kind of this politics of working with these student collectives. And if you had ideas or ways to think about having these conversations either between student groups or even within student groups. So I was thinking, is there a way to engage Blackness or to actually, this is another random thing. I think you and I went to the same Zapatista uprising event at Omni Commons and maybe 2019, I'm pretty sure. It's this wonderful. Right before the pandemic. I saw you.
Pablo was there too.
Right. Okay. I think we were all there. I wasn't familiar at the moment. But that was, I think, a moment where it's an example of how communities can come together. And there's a moment between Native, I just got to witness older men, middle-aged men, Native American, but also like Mexican Native people speaking to each other and just talking about these differences. And so it was a beautiful moment. And I thought that might be a great example to bring in or to talk about the different politics of having more of horizontal discussions between university student groups across nationalities, just thinking about class and power and moving beyond these tropes that are actually really harmful. And I think what they do is like kind of damage a territory of our soul. Like there's a reason why people are underachieving. Winter argues this. It's also the Wixárika students were arguing, you know, this is built in the education system, how we're socialized. So not sure how I'm doing on time, but I just wanted to ask if you thought of other ways to engage kind of this collective consciousness or collective conscious building. So I think I'll pause right there. I do have other kind of line of flight questions. If either of you have any thoughts about the Vatican's recent statement about apologizing for the doctrine of discovery, I think that might be also relevant to talk about in many contexts, but I'll just leave it at that. Thank you.
I just want to say that we're doing good on time, so feel free to continue this very exciting conversation.
Yeah, I think this is a great, I guess, the next few minutes we can talk, Pablo, Maria, and I. And there's so much there. And I think I'll start with maybe just speak to a little bit this question of the politics of working horizontally across space across identities. And that's really been a lot of the focus of my work since I finished my PhD, which is now 10 years ago. Sylvia Winters has also been very instructive in that, you know, in that there's this need to bring conversation across borders. And those borders, as Pablo mentioned, sometimes they're regional, right? Those borders exist within Guadalajara, those borders exist here in the East Bay. And I really believe in this idea of a poetics of relation that Glisson talks about, the capacity that we have to listen to each other without imposing upon one another particular strict fixed ideas of what our identities are supposed to be. And I do think that the Wixárika organizations, some of the organizations I speak to in this book no longer exist, others still do. Many of them were very intersectional. And one of the ones that I think has been the most kind of exemplary is this one that's called Jóvenes Indígenas Urbanos, Young Indigenous Urban Residents of the Metropolitan Zone of Guadalajara. And what was so remarkable and what has been so remarkable about that organization is that it's intertribal, but it's also very inclusive towards working class mestizos. And it's been very inclusive towards folks who may even come from more middle-class backgrounds who are interested in collaborating. But what I think has been very remarkable is that they're very clear at making sure that it is their, the indigenous working-class students who are making the decisions, who are kind of leading, marcando la pauta, as we say in Spanish. But allowing an openness, allowing a relationality that goes beyond these colonial representations of fixity. And I think that there has been a lot of gain. I was telling Pablo earlier, I don't think that there's a walking back. I don't think that there's a reversal to these spaces that have been opened. I think they keep on opening and they keep on expanding. And there are many more Wixárika undergraduates now that are continuing this generational, intergenerational work. And I think that that is very horizontal and has been very inclusive.
You know, what's interesting is that you mentioned, especially at the end of the book, that so many other indigenous groups are moving to places like Guadalajara. And I mean, you see it also, they're moving to different other cities, right? Monterrey, mm-hmm. They're moving to Tijuana along the border, especially when attempting to cross. Many of them are going to places, especially, for instance, Oaxaqueños going through the migrant trail. And upon arriving to certain locations are being labeled not as indigenous, but as migrants, mm-hmm. Internal migrants and just migrants in transit. And that means that certain types of rights or access to certain rights are not afforded to them because of that, right? So there's something there, I think, in the way that the state, in assuming some form of like, okay, this is, we're open to so many more understandings and besides just being Mexican, is using that, as you said, to fix ways of governing, mm-hmm. especially around the kind of migration routes that are now being taken by many. But for instance, if you're Purépecha and you move to Guadalajara, it traditionally isn't a place for Purépecha. And so I think Wixárika youth are opening spaces for people then, to be able to express them being Purépecha or other groups that otherwise wouldn't, right? Because in Guadalajara, they would just be known as laborers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, migrantes.
Migrantes.
Galeros.
Right? And so this I think this is what we see, for instance, and we talked about this prior, Diana, that, for instance, if we were to take it to the U.S. context, and again, these are very, not, there's they resonate, they're not the same, but when we looked at, for instance, mid 20th century urbanization of native peoples, especially in places like Denver, Colorado, the Bay Area, Los Angeles, all these different places where we have huge amounts, not just of, say, for instance, California natives, but people from the Dakotas in terms of Lakota, Dene, all these different places, and are now in relationship and in relation with and encountering each other, right? As Maria was mentioning, and what that actually creates, right? Similarly to what the lore of how Zapatismo emerges, right? The pluri-ethnic communities of Tzotzil, Tzotzal, and everyone, right? That in these spaces they're doing that, right? While the state imagines them in so many different ways, depending on how and what they need them for, right? And so I'm curious in regards to that, where these intellectuals, students, what role do they play in that, especially in the national politics of, say, for instance, the Congreso Nacional Indígena, the CNI, or in other kinds of activism that is happening throughout not only the country but across the continent, right? So I'm just throw that out there.
Yeah, I mean, I think that the connection with, like, I think that that what we see is the, you know, the nation state displacing, distorting, reducing, extracting, and at the same time, intergenerationally, people finding tools to continue with dignity, to relate with dignity. And I think that these intertribal spaces have been really powerful, you know, like the Congreso Nacional Indígena, like the intertribal Friendship House here in Oakland. They are these spaces that came out of these state policies in many ways, the unintended consequences, and the ways in which people are making sense of these new locations, right? Kind of returning to something I read earlier, right? Let me try to find it. A search for freedom within particular surroundings, right? So there's always this search for freedom, for autonomy, cognitive autonomy, which is something that Sylvia Winter also talks about, that so defies the colonial packaging that still is doing so well, you know. And one of my biggest concerns lately has been around activism, and this is the way in which Wixárika culture has now been at the center of psychedelic extractivism. And you see the repercussions of this in the way in which people are having to negotiate expectations of them as Indigenous people steeped within these psychedelic traditions, right? And it's just the newest version of capitalism, new age, indigenista, you know, it's quote unquote woke, and it's incredibly harmful at the same time. And that's, I think, speaks to that multiculturalism, right? That's very different from spaces of rebellious dignity or dignidad rebelde. It's a neoliberal multiculturalism that continues to seize hold of our bodies and of our territories for particular intentions. And I see these young people across these different scales continuing to push against that from their various positions. Some of them are now lawyers. Some of them are now working in police departments. Some of them might be the heads of human rights commissions, and they're still critical of these institutions that they're a part of. But I did want to share that right now.
Yeah, I read this as, or I thought about, like, the Winter writes, the plot in the plantation. I guess the tools for opposition or for reimagining can always reemerge, even within, like, these spaces of oppression.
Yeah, and the current Mexican government, I think, has been very Machiavellian in the way that it's used indigeneity, that it's labeled itself as the fourth transformation. Mm-hmm. Most recently, it essentially created these quote-unquote justice plans, and the Wixárika were one of the three Indigenous peoples that were selected, and it's the Wixárika justice plan, and it's very performative, and it replicates, mm-hmm, I think, that 500 years of history that I somehow try to speak to, you know, under these particular discourses that at the same time still fix people in these very problematic ways to the colonial imaginary and to Indigenous people serving these particular purposes for the wider mestizo gaze, the white and mestizo policies, the white and mestizo universities that may pat themselves on their backs for having more Indigenous students now. And I think that those parallels, I'm so glad, Maria, that you bring kind of those parallels to the experiences here, because I think that that also is how it emerged, you know, from my own navigation of what it meant to be who I am in higher ed and try to explain these things in hostile circumstances.
Yeah, and it's a tension I'm reading, as you mentioned, this co-option even in higher education of recognition. I'm like, well, I as a critique, I'm like, I'm a biracial person, but I'm kind of taken to represent all Black people, even though I come from a family of like working class, like dark-skinned Black people. Like there's these same kind of politics of what becomes like an acceptable racialized subject are still ingrained even in this like multicultural perspective. It's like, it's not all Black, it's a particular type, and that you have to fit and then constantly reify. You know, it's a middle class or an upper class, or it's a college educated reification, and it's harmful and it's dangerous in many different contexts. So I think it's actually my politics are like, I'm going to call it out when I see it, or I'll make really subversive jokes about how we all look alike, we're all related in our department, or at least the Black people, just because it's my way of rationalizing, okay, it's also critiquing how we are acceptable or not acceptable, or how we operate. Even though I'm in a part of this position, I still think it's like, it's important because we're not all monolithic people, or our families don't represent kind of what we see in this academy.
Yeah.
And I'm also curious that while many of these social movements, especially in the moment in the 90s, in particular, the Zapatista uprising in 94, opens up so much, right? It isn't solely just the changes to the Constitution, to, you know, article changes to make it a pluriethnic country. That's a response to mobilization. And so when thinking about that, especially in spaces that, where, for instance, Guadalajara has gone through tremendous amount of social upheaval, especially when you think about how conservative it is, and then when thinking about how it's created as this kind of criollo supremacist kind of location, right? That at least constructed as such. I know you mentioned that that's not necessarily reality. I mean, it's always been a place of so much of what Mexico is, and how it has now talked about questions of same-sex marriage, LGBTQ rights in particular. And now in the image that you had of them, you know, of Wixárika elders or responsables going to hacer demandas, right? The very appearance of that is so contrary to Guadalajara in its as it's been constructed over the last 100 years. Yeah. And I'm curious if the last images of I'm not trying to play devil's advocate whatsoever, but the performances, the installation, while those are, I think, forms of you know, aquí estamos y no nos vamos, right? The sense of like, we are here, if it also doesn't serve the purpose of, right? Mm-hmm. Of a place like Guadalajara being able to say, we can market off of this, right? So it fits within the neoliberal construct.
Absolutely. I mean, and I think that that's where actually those two images, on the one hand, Atilano, who was also a university student, he created that installation, and he's known how to negotiate, you know, and he's over 20 years, had to continually assert his right to sell his artwork in public spaces. Now he's, you know, creating public installations. And I think that that can speak to potentially two different tendencies. On the one hand, maybe there has been a change in progress. And on the other hand, it fits really well into the multicultural branding that Guadalajara has wanted to adopt as a city that is no longer white supremacist, Catholic, patriarchal, right? On the flip side, that poster for the event isn't catering to anybody but the Wixárika community that's already there, you know? And I think that that is what is the right to opacity, the right to not have to always have our spaces be multicultural, right? And I think that those two tendencies might, you know, that tension can be the productive way forward, right? Is knowing that even if there is this, a mural or a contract that the state gives, that people are going to continue to walk in their autonomous ways. And the theme of walking is so central, right? Makuyeka, walking in many ways and in many places. That is the way in which we learn geography, right? So maybe we need questions from the audience now, huh? Let's see.
Thank you for that very interesting conversation. Yes, we have two questions for the audience. I'm going to ask them, and please feel free to join in. You're all welcome to answer them and share your thoughts. So the first question comes from Mari Olivar. What are your thoughts about the current reinvigoration of the application to make Irikuta an UNESCO World Heritage Site?
Thank you. Well, that's a big question. So Wirikuta, which is one of the very important sacred places in San Luis Potosí, and that's been the site of mining, agro-industry, most recently psychedelic organizations purchasing small farmer land and privatizing it with the intention of giving it supposedly back to the indigenous people. It's a very big controversy. You know, through all of this, Wirikuta has been on a list of World Heritage Sites that could potentially get protection by the UNESCO. But the reality is quite different. There are so many places in the world that are on this list. Mexico's already received several of these sites. And so it is this kind of global competition for who gets the next UNESCO World Heritage protection. But I think, you know, deeper than that is, what does a UNESCO World Heritage Site mean for the small farmers who live in Wirikuta, or mean for the Wixárika people? Is it legible? Is it a legible way of defending? Does it have teeth to actually protect it from mining, from agro-industry, or from the privatization of what is otherwise a land that's held in common, that was never seen as private property, and that now is being parceled off very much the way Marx talked about it, you know, back in the day in England. And so, you know, it's interesting to think about the World Heritage Site as the access to defense, but I think that a lot of what I've learned from a lot of the youth activists and the elder activists is that it also is quite illegible as a form of defense. And it's been a very long process that we may never see the end to. But that's a great question to think about.
I don't know if Pablo and Maria have any comments about that.
I have a question. Like, with a UNESCO designation, could that just encourage more tourism, like more kind of commodification and consuming of a cultural identity that is like either static or really specific? So I could see.
I think it's more possible. Dangerous. Great way to think about it, you know. Mm-hmm. How is that a form of representation? Yeah. How is that a form of creating particular ideas of mm-hmm. boundaries?
Yeah. The other thing, so I've actually done a lot of traveling in Chiapas, and just visiting some caracoles, like the Zapatista run caracoles, like they're, I'm thinking about like more of the tourist site. There's a few that are like completely in the autonomous community is completely like Zapatista run. And I'm like, could that be like, would a UNESCO designation necessarily mean like it would be a Wixárika run? could it be like a more like a Zapatista model of actually this is ours and we will dictate the terms of visitation of relation? And I don't know if it would. These are my questions.
Yeah, I mean, I think that that's actually a very interesting way into thinking about it. And I would add that in these sacred lands, these are shared lands, right? There are other communities that live there, some who are indigenous, some who are indigenous folks who were displaced, who migrated at different points. And one of the things that I've been trying to articulate more and more, and that I see coming from the bases, is that protection for land can't go back to these orthodox ways of categorizing who belongs and who doesn't and who gets, you know. And I think the small farmers, they're the ones who live there, who are very familiar with what's been changing and what needs protection. And one of the sad things is that in this kind of hypervisibility, you get new age allies, white folks from the north who don't see the small farmers, right? Because they're mestizo, they don't have trajes, they don't have that shamanistic glitter. And that to me is one of the big dangers too. You know, how do we live in relation? How do we think about land in relation? And the Wixárika see this land not as property, but as Tate Yurianaka, our mother fertile earth. And that's a very different relationship to territory than even what the UNESCO has. So still been thinking about it. And I think the Zapatista idea could be interesting, you know, in terms of how do people form these autonomous forms of governance in these shared spaces.
But I think the response is what the Congreso Nacional Indígena is trying to do, right? That is in part, a couple of things could happen with this making it a World Heritage Site, that you have to prove or show a particular type of indigeneity so that people would, it has to now be front and center. And the state is the one that will have to, in a sense, intervene in that and say, well, we're, how we understand its usage. Like, is this actually a site for this? Is it actually an important spiritual historical site, right? And there, how much of this, for instance, intellectual growth amongst generations now of intellectuals, historians, elders, folks who know that story, it both can, if it's mobilized, it could create that sense of like the story being passed on of why it's important, why these sites are important, right? That is that on one level you can create that and support that and give it all, I think, the weight of how indigenous governance and especially autonomous governance is happening in the region with all the different conversations that are being had. But on the other end, the state can intervene and say, well, we're only going to really talk about what this, you know, heritage site means to these people here. The other ones aren't necessarily authentic enough, right? Mm-hmm. So it always comes down to this question of the authenticity aspect of it. It's the same when we think about, for instance, flamenco and where flamenco has to be performed for it to be that, right? Or some of the other places that we've seen throughout in Latin America that become heritage sites, right? So I think you can find some of those glimpses as to what that would mean. The Zapatista model of the Caracol or the Aguas Calientes before that is that's a political cultural center of autonomy, right? And so those are places primarily for encounter. What happens in the decision makings is only when we started to see, for instance, the Juntas de Buen Gobierno after 2003, all these different kinds of formations, which takes organization. And what I see in your book is the organization that's happening now, not only in the communities, but also now in these neighborhoods, in these cities. And that in and of itself, I think, can add so much to how they will, for instance, mobilize in two distinct locations against, whether it be hydroelectric dams, whether it be extraction by Canadian, there's always a Canadian company somewhere, a Canadian company, right? Any of these different things, and how they mobilize on two different fronts, because the urban, especially among student activism, is necessary, but it's also the kind of the urban movement of making these important issues at the front of it will show if it goes farther than the region, right? If it's taken on, and that's what we're seeing. Tren Maya, what's happening in Yaqui territory, what's happening in amongst Wixárika communities, right?
Yeah.
Thank you. I think we have time for one more quick question. I want to be respectful with all of our time. Would love to hear your thoughts on the roles of art, activism, and spirituality for Wixárika youth.
Thank you, Edgar. It's good to see you here. I think the role of art and activism, spirituality has gone really hand in hand. And I'll return to Sylvia Winter for that, because Sylvia Winter is like brilliant in the way she reminds us that, you know, the Western Big Bang has been one that secularizes us, right? And that secularism is very harmful as well. And when we consider the relationship of these territories, you know, and that those images I showed you, art, activism, and spirituality are put to work through those spaces, are put through to work through that relationship that those spaces hold. So Wixárika art is constantly based on this interplay between these sacred places and how the individual is navigating it. You know, what is the particular story? A lot of the art speaks to hardships, speaks to struggle, speaks to the sacrifice of getting to those sacred lands. And I think that for a lot of the youth today, that is still the way in to these deeper aspects of culture, right? That help them tie together the celestial world with the terrestrial realities. And dreaming is a part of that. And the dreams come through in the art, and they come through in the activism. You know, that embroidered traje that Hayuan Eme did, you know, it was essentially like this nightmare that he had to work through to try to push back on these official celebrations of indigeneity that were happening in the midst of continued exploitation. So, you know, I do think that not just for Wixárika youth, but I think for a lot of young people today, there is this pursuit of how art, activism, and spirituality connect to free the individual and the collective, both. And I think that that's what that cognitive autonomy is about. Same for the Zapatistas. Clyde Woods talks about it in the Blues Epistemology, right? And there's a lot of weaving together and threading together that comes through in those practices.
I don't know if Maria or Pablo have any last comments, thoughts.
I don't think I can speak to it in terms of Wixárika youth, but thinking about Clyde Woods or the blues or hip hop tradition, as you know, it's especially Black creative expression always comes from, like, it's particularly like lower class, so like working class Black people, sometimes middle class, but it's a form of expression that's an expression. It's both individual, but it's also legible as a collective. And it's, I guess we're always reading and iterating on it, but it's also a way of like speaking to each other. And I think that might be a useful way of thinking about art and activism and spirituality. It's like the blues is spiritual. Like my auntie would tell you that hip hop is spiritual. It's I think it speaks to like a soul, you know, in a way. And even a collective soul, and just different kind of emotions. So I think thinking about art in that way as both it's an individual expression, but it's also a conversation, like amongst like a group that can also recognize that it's like mutual recognition might be useful or helpful for people.
Yeah, I would I would just add that you have, in terms of what is now called artivism, the way that artists, musicians, and others are themselves reconceptualizing what it means to be in community, reshaping even their own craft and the way that they're marketed and so forth. I look at, for instance, that generation, again, in the 90s, coming out of the explosion of the 92 rebellions in Los Angeles, of so many different kind of youth of color in particular, Chicana and Chicano, Central American, Black youth in LA and other places, and how many different groups came out of that, right? In particular, Quetzal, other groups that I think mirror and speak to the quotidian lives of a changing city like a place like Los Angeles. You saw that throughout, I think, the United States and how important that is. I'm glad folks have been mentioning Clyde because, Clyde Woods, the late Clyde Woods was, and I'll say this, he was a mentor to many, but he was a mentor to a lot of Chicano sociologists and intellectuals when they didn't have anybody to mentor them. So you think about that aspect of how we think and how we see the world. Clyde's view of like the Delta and looking at the blues and everything inspired so many in that they can at least, again, resonate with a lot of the projects that they themselves were doing, especially when it came to such important things like cultural production, which is so central to shaping new horizons, right? And so yeah. I definitely thank you. Folks, read the book. Read the book. It's really good. I had to at least say that part, right?
Pull up all the read this book.
Yeah. Read the book.
Thank you, Professor Negrín, Professor Gonzalez, Maria, for being here. It's been a pleasure listening to all your wonderful, very interesting conversation. Thanks for being here. Have a great end of the semester. We look forward to seeing you next year. Any last comments, thoughts are welcome.
That was the wrong button, sorry.
No, I just thought, I think that's it. We, I think the invitation right here is to find those spaces, that bring us freedom, those sounds that bring us freedom, those smells and activities that help us move past the many constraints that we're up against. Mm-hmm. So that's the big lesson too. Thank you, Maria. Thank you, Pablo.
Thank you.
Thank you, Janet, Center for Latin American Studies, Publico.
Thank you. So